believe I've heard of the story, but it sounds intriguing, so let's begin. So, sentencing Peter Thomas Anthony Manuel to death at Glasgow in May 1958, the judge, Lord Cameron, said, "A man may be very bad without being mad." Manuel, who callously killed at least 9 people, certainly qualified as very bad. But does a sane man pick victims at random, murder for no apparent reason, attempt to extort money from a man he has made a widower, then eagerly offer the evidence that will lead him to the gallows? Manuel was certainly no fool. Halfway through his trial, he dismissed his lawyers and conducted his own defense so well that Lord Cameron congratulated him on his performance. He used legal knowledge studied during his frequent prison sentences for burglary, theft, indecent assault, rape, and violence. But he forgot one vital fact. In Scotland, a multi-murderer is charged with every killing. In England, on the other hand, he would have been charged with only one of them, on the grounds that evidence of other crimes might prejudice a jury unfairly. Manuel's astonishing record as a killer reads like that of a gangster in Chicago, and he would have been proud of the comparison. He was, in fact, born in America. His parents left Scotland for New York in the 1920s, and Peter was born there in 1927. But the Depression forced them back to Britain, and their misfit son was soon in trouble. By the time he was 16, a senior probation officer said he had the worst record he had ever known in a boy. In January 1956, Manuel added murder to that record. Anne Neelands was just 17 years old. She was waiting for her boyfriend in an East Kilbride street when Manuel met her. He had rugged, teddy boy good looks, and she agreed to go to a nearby cafe with him. But as he walked home later, he suddenly dragged her into a wood and smashed her to death, beating her skull with a piece of iron. Police were baffled by the seemingly motiveless attack. They interviewed all the possible suspects on their books, including Manuel. But scratches on his face down to hogmanay excesses. I don't know what that says, or what that means, sorry. Manuel had had enough police interviews in his life to know exactly what to say. During that summer, Manuel, the rebel without a cause, decided he needed a gun. His criminal ego was growing. He had killed once and got away with it. He could do it again. On the 16th of September in 1956, he and two other men and a woman went on a robbery expedition to the wealthy area of High Burnside, a few miles south of Glasgow. They plundered one empty house and even started a drinking party there. Manuel pointed out another home nearby, but the others were reluctant to stage a second break-in. Manuel went alone. Getting in on the ground floor, he went straight upstairs and saw two women asleep in one room. He opened another bedroom door and saw 16-year-old Vivian Watt. She was awake and sat up in fear when she spotted him. Manuel bounded across the room, knocked her out, and tied her up. Then he returned to the other room. Mrs. Marion Watt, a semi-invalid, and Vivian's mother, was still asleep. So was her sister, Mrs. Margaret Brown. Manuel calmly drew his gun and shot them both at close range. Then he walked back hands. Holding her roughly down on the bed, he shot her through her left eye. Manuel interfered with the nightdresses of all three women, but again, did not touch them. Expert witnesses later declared that he got sexual satisfaction from killing without the need for contact. It was 3 a.m. when he rejoined his pals in the first house, and about 5 a.m. when they went back to Glasgow. But Manuel's shot had not killed Vivian instantly. Her body was still warm when the family's daily help arrived next morning, and if that gave Manuel added satisfaction, the next development delighted his twisted mind. Police arrested Mrs. Watt's husband, William, and accused him of the three murders. Had been staying at a hotel in Lochgilphead. I don't know if I pronounced that correctly. It's spelled L-O-C-H-G-I-L-P-H-E-A-D. 80. It was 80 miles away on the night of the killings. Witnesses had seen him there at midnight and 8 a.m., but police proved it was possible for him to have driven to his home and back in those 8 hours, and they had witnesses who swore they had seen Mr. Watt in his car on the Renfrew ferry at 3 a.m. The unfortunate man spent 2 months in prison before he was set free. The police could find no reason why a prosperous, loving father would kill his happy family, but Mr. Watt's ordeal was not over for Peter Manuel, who had equally little reason for killing his loved ones, now tried to extort money from the bereaved man. First, he told Watt's solicitor he could name the Burnside murderer for a price. Then he met Mr. Watt and offered to remove lingering suspicions by killing the Burnside murderer and making it look like suicide. It would only cost £120. The baker declined. Manuel was playing with fire, but amazingly, he got away with it. And he was also continuing to kill. On December 8th, 1957, he took a train to Newcastle-upon-Tyne, south of the border. He then took a taxi and ordered Sydney Dunn, the driver, to a deserted moorland road near Edmund Byers, then shot and stabbed him. Just after Christmas, he met 17-year-old Isabel Cook on the outskirts of Glasgow, dragged her into a field, tore off most of her clothes, and strangled her. He then buried the girl he had never seen before in a shallow grave. While the rest of Scotland was sleeping off Hogmanay. I don't know what that means. Does anybody know? Let me know in the comments. Manuel broke into the Glasgow bungalow of Peter Smart on New Year's Day, 1958. He found £25 in a wallet and could have left undetected because Mr. Smart, his wife Doris, and their son Michael had not heard a thing. Instead, Manuel went into their bedrooms and shot all three dead. Then he calmly fed 2 tins of salmon to the family cat, which, like, what the heck, that's so weird. But at last, Manuel, I don't know how to pronounce it, I hope I'm saying it okay. But at last, Manuel had made a mistake. Under routine surveillance, as he was of the every meter crime, he was seen passing some new blue 5-pound notes. Notes of the type Peter Smart had drawn from the bank before his death. The home Manuel shared with his parents was searched, and after discovering housebreaking equipment, the police arrested both Manuel and his father. Manuel then agreed to make a statement on condition that his father was released. What he told them was an emotionless, detailed story of his murders. The cold-blooded confession. compassion stunned hardened officers who reported that. When he led them to Isabel Cook's grave, he said almost lightheartedly, "This is the place. In fact, I think I'm standing on her now." Manuel craved the limelight and longed to be feared as a big man, but neither the police nor the court were awed by his exploits. After listening to 250 witnesses and a 3-hour closing speech from Manuel himself, the jury found him guilty of 7 of the 8 murders with which he was charged. The Newcastle killing was outside Scottish jurisdiction, and the killing of Anne Nealance was not proven.